really enjoying that. Really enjoying the place and the hospitality of the people. So thank you so much for allowing me to have this experience. My name is C.Testa-O'Neill. I'm a senior consultant for a company called Corio, Europe's largest SQL Server house. And essentially, I specialise in business intelligence within the company. So, a little bit about me. I'm a SQL Server MVP. I've been for a number of years now. I'm also a Microsoft Certified Trainer. For any of you that do Microsoft e-learning courses in SQL Server 2008, I wrote the entire Microsoft Certified Technical Specialist track in e-learning. So if you don't need to use SQL, Dev, Admin, or BI, it's my ugly photograph of those courses. So yeah, so I'm an author of SQL e-learning. Some of you may be aware of SQL Bits. I'm one of the organizers of SQL Bits. We run a conference usually twice a year, Europe's largest SQL Server conference, and I also run the UK SQL Server user group, where it's a collection of user groups around the UK that does it. As some people in this audience will find out tonight, my biggest passion in life is playing guitar. So occasionally you will see me in some bars, at conferences, late at night, playing guitar, and ending up on YouTube somewhere in Dennis recording. So, yeah, could have had a very different career 6 years ago. I had a choice, should I focus on my SQL career, or should I stay in the band that I was at the time, and now the story with Guns N' Roses, Metallica, bands like that, Papa Roach, and I think I might have made a mistake. I have really. It's a pleasure to actually here to share information. Now, I'll be really honest with you, I know Gorsha's done a session early this morning, and I'm not sure how much crossover there is, because if we take a look at the agenda, the objective behind the session really is to serve two purposes. It's really to give someone who's not really used analysis services before a head start and a heads up on how to get TQ, talking about best practices as we go along. And the second phase to this is that some of you may have built queues already, so it's an opportunity for you to ask questions as we go along the way. So what we're going to cover is introducing analysis services. We're going to talk about how we actually get the data. And what I've always done, even as far back as SQL 7, I've always worked on my dimensions first. And we'll explore those dimensions, focusing specifically on hierarchies and attribute relationships. And once my dimensions are created, then I'll start to look at creating the queue itself. And here the focus is on the kind of measures that we want to actually do analysis against, and how we can organize that through measures groups, partitions and applications designs. And then finally, look at how you can browse the queue. Now, how many people use SQL Server 2012? Not many people. Okay, and just hold that thought for a minute. I'll explain why I'm doing this particular session. What I do want to bring to your attention is that it's not a full exploration of the queue properties yet. There's too many of them to go through in an hour. And we are focusing on the key properties that you need to understand to get your queue up and running. Additional analysis services components, such as MDX calculations, key performance indicators, translations and perspectives, are also not covered. And we won't be looking at administration and maintenance or security. We're very much taking this from the perspective of a BI developer rather than an administrator. I mean, for me to do all that content would probably take me about 3 days. And what I'm giving you here is a snapshot of what analysis services is all about. So, why am I still doing this session today? I've been doing this session for years. I was at a conference at the back end of last year and was absolutely amazed at how many people thought analysis services in its traditional form seems to be going out the window. I actually corrected that because I was concerned that people were going to leave that conference with the wrong idea. Now, how many of you have heard of Tabular? Yeah? Okay? So that's less than half the room. Tabular is a new form of analysis services that uses what's called the vertipath, or also known as the x-velocity engine, that can retrieve data extremely quickly because of the nature of the compression algorithms that are used. The biggest data set I've seen turned in less than 1 second by Tabular is 4.8 billion euros. It is that good, yeah? So the marketing message from Microsoft, particularly in the last 18 months, has been about analysis services in the context of Tabular. This has given a lot of people the impression that multidimensional views, which is the original incarnation of analysis services, is out the window. I mean, it did cause a stir back in past 2010. 2010, where the first announcement came out about Tabular. You know, I think basically there were protests going on, to put it mildly, with regards to, you know, multidimensional, what's going to happen with it, are you going to still use it, is it a bad? Now, I'm not sure how much of you are aware of that, but what I want to bring to your attention is that the traditional way of doing analysis services, the multidimensional method, is very much alive, yeah? And it's going to be around probably for a few more releases. Because at the end of the day, Tabular is extremely good, but it's done on the basis that you've got plenty of memory in order to fulfill the query requests. But the second consideration of Tabular that's often overlooked is that the programming language that you use to query analysis, to query Tabular analysis services is DAX. And DAX at the moment has got off to a great start, but in the context of NDX, it's not sophisticated enough, really, to do complex calculations that NDX can do. So when you're faced with a situation where you've got cubes that are sat on a server where memory resources are quite low, or the complexity of the cube is such that DAX can't really handle the kind of calculations you can do. I mean, Andre just did a session before mine in the other room, he was talking about the banking sector and how complex the risk analysis gets. There's elements really that where DAX wouldn't be able to fulfill that at the moment. So I guess the way to look at multidimensional cubes at the moment is they are pretty much the father of analysis services at the moment. They've been around for many years. And Tabular is an emerging technology in this release that will get better and better and better with each release that comes on. I don't think it's going to be too long before it catches up. But the reality of the situation is there's plenty of people doing fantastic presentations about Tabular at the moment. And because of what happened at that conference, I actually went up to the organizer and said, I see you've got 3 slots available. I'd like to take it. And literally, just the objective behind that session was running this aid. Multidimensional is going to stay around. Whoever told you it's not going to be here, they're wrong. Okay. So we've probably got another 3 or 4 releases about it. There's another reality as well to bear in mind. How many people put their hands up to SQL Server 2012? Not many. Yeah? It's a fantastic product, but a lot of you, how many people use it in 2008? Yeah? R2? Yeah? What about 2005? What about 2000? What about 7?
Got one customer who said.
Yeah. So this presentation I'm giving you is essentially version agnostic. What I'm talking about applies to 2005, 2008, and 2012. So you can go away and apply these key points to cubes within your environment at the moment. So if you don't know what analysis services is, it's the component of SQL Server that's used for querying and analysing data. And typically, what analysis services will map to is an underlying data warehouse. A data warehouse basically is just a database in the database engine that acts as the source of your data. Within the data warehouse, you will have dimension tables and fact tables. Fact tables contain the measures that you want to analyse. Total sales, for example. Yeah? The dimensions are really important because they provide the context against the fact data which your users will browse against. And the reason why I spend so much time on dimensions, I think Provoz and I had a conversation in the MVP panel last night, is that this is really what they use to delve into the data. So you've got to have an understanding of your users' business requirements so that you design dimensions and their associated hierarchies appropriately. The core objective analysis services is a cube. And it's the cube that stores both detailed and pre-aggregated data within it. So essentially, some of the analysis you do could be done against a relational database for a T-SQL query. But if those queries get bigger with more joins, then that query performance goes down, and then we have to consider persisting that data in a native analysis services queue so they can pre-aggregate that data, physicalize it within a queue, so when you're retrieving that aggregated result set, it's not calculating it on the fly, it's already there. And this is done through a process that is actually called queue processing. Queue processing is what sucks up the data from the data source and pre-aggregates it and stores the detail within the queue. The great news is, when I used to teach analysis services years ago, it was quite embarrassing to talk about the lack of clients that they had. You know, Excel was the client that you use. What I can say now, that's changed lots, where the focus has been on the application layer from Microsoft's perspective, where you've got reporting services that can be a client, Excel, and also you can use Performance Point and SharePoint. Not to mention now we've got this new Tabular instance that basically can make use of Power View within SQL Server 2012. So the range of clients are actually exploring this data and having fun with it, because that's why I like it, to have fun with data. It's a lot better than it was in the past. So, as I've alluded to a moment ago, there's a number of reporting methods that you can use. And we did acknowledge that some of the queries that you issue against analysis services could potentially be done against a relational database. And as we know, the RTM variants, they normalize the tables, the query data, but as the number of joins get bigger and bigger, basically the query performance will decrease. Tabular does address this a lot better because it's using the burst pack engines. When it sucks up that data, it's within burst pack. But really, before Tabular, multi-dimensional approaches, online analytical processes, you can see there, stores one or more cubes that stores that data in a central repository for reporting and analytical purposes. There's a really cool area of analysis services, though, that a lot of people overlook, and you know, I get involved occasionally on projects with data mining. And data, are you all familiar with what data mining is? Yeah? Yeah? I think, as a quick example, the most famous example of a data mining exercise was Walmart in the US, who, after mining all the data, established that between the hours of 6 till 7, or I think it was 5 till 7, on a Friday night, the two most popular items that were put in a shopping basket was nappies and beer. They were the two most common items. This was not known to them until that data mining exercise. So the raw data there said that nappies and beer were the two most common selling items. Then they did a study on why that was. And it's like, get a phone call at work, on your way off, and you pick up some nappies. The bloke will pick up the nappies, and apparently, to rebuild our masculinity, we'd grab a six-pack of beer as well. I know certainly Walmart in the UK and the US, it's called Asda in the UK, the nappies and the beer are on the next aisle to each other. They are. So watch out for that. So data mining provides you with a really, really fun tool to explore patterns of data, trend analysis, and it's pretty cool, but I know a lot of companies don't really use that side of analysis services. So what do we have to do first? Well, we have to get the data. And in order to get the data, there are two objects that we need to create analysis services. We've got the data source, and this simply provides the connection information to your source data. Typical connection strings include the server name, the authentication mechanism that you're using to connect to the data source, and finally, the database that contains the source data. This is typically a data warehouse. But having a connection is not enough. Once you've got the connection that gives you the gateway to your data, you then have to create a data source view that allows you to define a subset of that data from within the data source. So it could be that your data warehouse contains data models that relate to many different areas of your business. You could have a finance data model, a HR data model. Yeah, these may be data models within a single data warehouse that are used for specifically business purpose. Essentially what we do is we use a data source view to pick out just the tables that we need to build that queue. And it allows you to focus on that area as well as doing offline development from the queue within Business Intelligence Development Studio, or in SQL 2012, it's called SQL Server Data Tools. So, how do we get the data? So what we're going to do is use SQL Server Data Tools. How many people use Business Intelligence Development Studio? Yeah, so if you use Business Intelligence Development Studio, it's going to be a very familiar environment to you. But for those of you who've never used Business Intelligence Development Studio, actually, once you get over the initial shock that it's Visual Studio, because I'll tell you, I spent years as a DBA trying to avoid Visual Studio. I didn't want to touch Visual Studio at all, but unfortunately, all good things come to an end. But actually, the transition into Visual Studio was pretty cool. Once I got over the shock, a couple of weeks, I was up and running for it. So what we're going to do is we're going to do File, New, Create Project, and that project will be an analysis services project. So within the business intelligence template, what we'll see is we've got an analysis services multidimensional instance, and we've got an analysis services tabular instance. One key point, those different types of instances, they have to be on separate instances. You cannot combine tabular and multidimensional on the same instance. So just be mindful. So it's not uncommon in business intelligence projects of 2012 to have at least maybe two instances of analysis services installed, because you've got the old multidimensional, which is I'm showing you, and then you've got tabular projects because you want to take advantage of the new technologies that's available. So I'm going to click on analysis services. I'm going to call it SQL base. And what we can do is we can give, and I recommend you give a different solution there. So within a single project, within a single solution, I have multiple projects for different things. So I don't just do analysis services, I do database engine creation through Visual Studio, I actually do reporting services and integration services as well. So for me now, Visual Studio, which is known as SQL Server Data Tools, now gives me the ability to do all my development from one place. And if you're working on a project with multiple members of the team, I highly recommend that you make use of Team Foundation Server so you can check in any updates to any aspects of your BI SQL Server development, and then you can control it through automated builds and so forth. So I highly recommend that this is used. So what we'll do is we'll call the solution Home, and I'll just create that project within the current directory. Actually, what I'll do, I'll put on the desktop in case I need to go back to it. Okay. So Solution Explorer on your right-hand side will populate with a number of objects specific to analysis services. In the context of actually getting the data, I'm looking at these first two folders. Yeah? Data sources and data source views. So if I right-click and do a new data source, it'll be a very, very familiar data source wizard where you can find a new connection and the name of this server. I think this one's Manchester. we'll use Windows Authentication, and then what it will do is it will give me a list of all the databases that are in this particular instance of SQL Server. Now, what we've got here is a database called AdventureWorks Data Warehouse 2012. This is going to be the source of the data. And just to click on OK there, and then finish off the wizard. Now, the impersonation information, for the benefit of this demonstration, I'm just going to use the service account, but I would not recommend doing that in a production environment. It's recommended that you have use a specific username and password for that purpose. Here, though, it just makes it a little bit easier without getting prompts and credentials. So what I'll do is I'll add ES at the end to say that's a data source, click on finish, and that's it. That's our data source done. Now, I will open up Management Studio, and in SQL Server Management Studio, we'll just have a quick glance at what's in the AdventureWorks DW2012 database. Okay, so what we'll do here is on the databases, here's AdventureWorks, here's all the tables, and basically the way that this database works is they've got a naming convention. Anything that's a dimension table is prefixed with DIM, and anything that's a fact table that contains all the measures that you're measuring is prefixed with fact. So for the benefit of those who are not really familiar with this, we're just going to select top 1,000 there. The dimension tables provide the context for the information. So as you can see here, we scroll across, we've got essentially the friendly names of what this is all about. Okay? You're familiar with the Rubik's Cube, yeah? Yeah, I like to think of a cube like a Rubik's Cube, where the dimensions are the stickers. Yeah, so we've got one dimension called red, one dimension called yellow, and then inside the cube, that's where all the detail is, so then we can mix and mash it and look at it in different flavours. What you generally find with a fact table is that the fact tables generally contain more numerical information because it's all done on foreign keys against the dimension table, so we've got a number of ordered data keys there. But as we go across, we start to get the actual measures, the unit price, the extended amount, etc., etc. Now, the reason I showed you this is essentially just to really focus on the data source view, because what the data source view was allowed me to do is we saw over 20, 30 tables in there, yeah? But I would create this queue for a specific business area. So what I can do is I can make use of the data source that I've just created, and then it will give me a list of all the tables we use. So what I'll do is I'll pull across back to internet sales, BIM, products, and BIM data. So essentially, I'm only adding three tables to this key. Very simple. So we'll call that DSV at the end to say it's a data source view, and basically we've now got our connections to the source data. Any questions so far? No? Okay. So, the data source view designer enables you to edit. It's a logical way, yeah? So any changes we make here does not impact the underlying physical database. So essentially, this is where you might want to customize column names. You could do it, you might want to do it at the ETL process as a choice. If you want to know more about that, see it at the end of the session, because it's a big discussion as to whether you materialize results in a data warehouse versus doing it in a queue. But basically, it gives you the ability to make changes that you want to do specific for the queue without affecting the underlying data itself, the underlying database scheme itself. But what we're going to look at is dimensions. So once you've got your connection to the source data, You're going to create dimensions that really provides the contextual information for the data in your queue. And this is where BI people, we tend to be, I personally agree with Jen Stirrup. When it comes to BI, the business is the most important thing. Yeah? Always get technology that meets the business requirement. Don't get technology for the sake of just getting technology. And from that perspective, dimensions for a business user is the way they are going to navigate around the data. And a lot of thought should be put into what exactly you include in that dimension. They will typically map to the DIN tables within a data warehouse. And what the dimensions do is define the cube axes on the Rubik's Cube. That's literally what they do. So it provides a navigation path for the users. You can selectively choose to add attributes that you feel that your business users need. And the key point to be aware of with regards to dimensions is whilst there's a lot of properties that you can configure, for me the important ones is the key column property, the name column property, and the order by property. Because this will control how your users will see the data when they first browse it. Time dimensions have a special case. Personally, I would rather create my own time dimension table within the data warehouse. But Analysis Services does automatically create a time dimension if you wish. And that time dimension data can be stored in the queue, or you can store it on a relational database engine. The reason why I don't use Analysis Services inbuilt time is many of my customers want some kind of customization with the bits. So it might be that here's a good one. In the UK we have pretty much set bank holidays, yeah, which the time dimension analysis services can accommodate. We've had a pretty freaky year this year because in June, unusually, we get an additional day to celebrate the Queen's Diamond Jubilee. So this is kind of a one-off thing that with the analysis services time dimension, it doesn't even recognise that. But at least within my dimension table, I could literally create a column called bank holiday flag and put a value of one in there so that we can do an analysis against bank holidays. Because there's some retailers who want to look at how well sales are doing on a bank holiday. Okay? Any questions so far? Okay. So, when you create a dimension, by default, you get an attribute hierarchy. And that attribute hierarchy simply consists of two levels. All, and the next level is every single record in that dimension table. As a result, you need to consider improving the readability of that dimension by using hierarchies. Imagine you've got a time dimension table that's holding data in from the year 1900 to the year 3000, right? That is a lot of days for a user to browse through. So what we'll do is we'll add levels to the dimension that improves the readability. Calendar year, quarter, week, for example. All of a sudden, the dimension list gets shrunk up massively, and then the users can easily browse to the specific year they want to look at, to the specific quarter, to the specific week. There are a number of different types of hierarchies available. A balanced hierarchy is where there's balance on both sides. So a real good example would be calendar year, quarter, and week. Yeah? Well, you can get some ragged hierarchies where in some levels of that hierarchy, there's missing levels. So a really good example of this might be country, state, and city. So we consider America, the United States, we've got Washington and Redmond, Washington being the state, Redmond being the city, but if we consider the country, Vatican City, well, Vatican City is also a state and it's also a city. So you can control that hierarchy so that it will skip levels because there's repetition, and that's called a rank hierarchy. Parent-child hierarchies look a little bit like ragged hierarchies, but the only reason the ragged is not because there's duplicate data at different levels. It's more to the point when you've got a self-joined relationship on a table. A prime example of this is an employee table where you've got a manager ID and an employee ID, and there's a self-joined to give you a link of who are the managers and who are the workers underneath. So we're only touching one aspect of hierarchy to get the key points across, but be mindful that you can create additional hierarchies to suit your browsing requirements. What often gets overlooked when it comes to analysis services, and when I get called in for performance problems, the first thing that I look for is, have they set attribute relationships? Attribute relationships do not need to be set at all, but it would be wise to set them, because if you don't, you increase your processing time and your query response time. Attribute relationships, I guess the way you could look at it is look at the dimension as being a table, and then look at the attribute relationship as being the indexes that kind of organize all that data together. Essentially, by default, all attributes have a relationship to the key column within your dimension table. There's just one to many relationships between them. There's a relationship with the key column within the actual table itself. So what we can do is, rather than just have one attribute relationship, we can basically start to define attribute relationships that map to the hierarchies that you've created. So if you create a hierarchy of calendar year, quarter, and month, then I would recommend defining an attribute relationship underneath on calendar year, quarter, and month. The reason for that is that the user is going to be browsing the data through that level, so it's the most queried navigation path within your dimension. And having attribute relationships that tells analysis services, yes, we know that month, and we know that quarter, and we know that year all maps to the decade, we know that, but actually, there's a more sophisticated relationship going on here, because months roll up into quarters, and quarters roll up into years. And that does something really important, because when analysis services comes to process the queue and create the queue, what it may well do is go, you know what, I'm not going to do aggregates for the year, because I can just do the aggregates at the quarter, and then we can infer the yearly aggregates from those quarters. So what it does is it saves space, there's less to do, and processing is quicker. So how many people have used attribute relationships? One person. Okay, two, three. Yeah? So I actually believe you're missing on a really, really, really good way to get performance improvements in query and processing just by setting attribute relations up. And I'll give you a demo, and I'll make the demo go wrong to show you the common problems that are associated with it, and I'll show you what the fixes are. Okay. So what are we going to do? We are going to go back into SQL Server Data Tools. I am now going to click on the Dimensions folder. I'm doing this, thank you. Right click, do New Dimension, click on Next. Now your options here is to use an existing table, and the middle two are to generate the timetables I was talking about, and the bottom option is to generate a non-timetable in the data source. Now for a good data warehousing business intelligence solution, you want to have control. You will already have a whole data warehouse there with the data that you need. So in that case, we're using an existing table. And that existing table will basically be from this data source view that we've just created, and the main table will be in that. Now what I want you to make note of at the moment is at the bottom here we've got a name column called Bear Key. Yeah, so just keep that in mind for a moment, that, because that becomes very important in about 5 minutes. Click on next. Choose the particular attributes that you want. So we'll have English date, no. We'll have English month, name. Month from the year, calendar quarter, calendar year. Okay? So these are the attributes that we're going to have within our dimension table.